good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm in love by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. Oh, and I've seen many searching for answers far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, 'cause you know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm in love by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. Can hardly speak. Peace so unexplainable. I can hardly think as you call me. Deeper still as you call. Thank you.
Good morning. Will everyone stand? We're going to sing Come Thou Fount.
Today to have Brother Noah Jackson with us to help us with our music. Lord willing, our hope is that he'll stay with us. We're going to have a little short period where he checks us out and we check him out and that kind of thing. Just see what God wants, you know, and that's our prayer. So Brother Noah is the band director at Brantley County High School now, and we're thankful to have him. Last year he was in the Georgia Redcoat Marching Band, so, I mean, that's a shoe-in right there. Amen, Brother Glenn. Where you at? There you are, you big Florida Gator, you. Amen. Well, yeah, it is what it is. But we're so thankful to have him today and looking forward to what God has in store for our church. The PM service tonight, the afternoon service, will be down here at the tent for the tent revival. We're going to go down here with Brother Kenny Marr. They're going to be down here at 7 o'clock. So if anybody would like to come, we'll all be down there at 7 o'clock. I think the rain's going to be cleared out. My hope is that it is. They told us we could put the tent on the ball field. I'm kind of glad we didn't because the clay would be bad. So, but Brother Kenny put it over to the side. I'm glad that you're all here today. If you can come tonight, that'd be a blessing. The March 28 activities, I got this somewhere on my desk up here. The housewarming for the new pastorium. If you notice, we got people using it already. Brother Kenny and his kids and Oliver. Hey, Brother White. Brother Kenny's kids are in there using it, and I'm glad. That was the goal. That was the goal. So the only problem is now I don't have anywhere to take a nap. So I may go over and scooch in there with them. So, but be in prayer for that and thankful for that. Having a housewarming so we can actually put things in it. There's already some things, but having a housewarming for that. The Easter activities will begin at 6 o'clock on the 28th here at the church. And a service followed by supper and a glow-in-the-dark egg hunt. That'll be awesome. So you guys come, and we'll all have a big time doing that. There'll be no food boxes this week. Is this old or this is new? This is new. No food boxes this week. Brother Justin, where are you at? We have 10 food boxes this week. And if anybody needs one, they're back here in the back, correct? And after church. There's also some cold stuff that I have to go in the boxes. So if you need a food box, listen, if you know somebody that needs one and you want to take it to their house, just see Brother Justin. We have 10 left over to take. Easter activities, a manna for many ministry on the second Saturday of each month. See Coach Carter. We may try to do a youth day with that. I was talking to Coach Carter. We got all kind of the cornhole games and horseshoes and basketball. Maybe get the youth out. We have a big time, and they can help give out some of the meals that we have. Just a thought. Maybe kids can come out and play. The Youth Biltmore Raffle ends this Wednesday. If you've bought any tickets for that, or if the kids have any tickets, make sure you get it to Bryant and Morgan. Also, pick up your Can't Stay Here shirts. If you ordered one, they're in the youth office. You can't stay here. If you need a t-shirt, I think there's some extra, maybe just a few. There are no 2X left over, because I didn't get one. I know you're shocked that I wear a shirt that big, but there were no 2Xs. So all you big fellas, there are no 2Xs. So I think they're smaller than that. So, but if you'd like one, please see Brother Bryant, and we'll move towards that. Are there any prayer requests today? Any prayer requests? Skip Skipper. Mr. Eldon Mixon. Nicholas Horn. Any others? Lenore. Miss Vera's sister, Lenore. Any others? Yes, sir? Miss Linda Hayslip. Say it again. Judy Cruz. Who said that? I can't. Who said that? Oh, right down here. I was looking over. Judy Cruz. You know, we take time to do this because it's important. I know I don't want everybody to think that, well, we're just killing time this morning. No, prayer is important. And we want to make sure that we don't leave anybody out if somebody has somebody that needs prayer. Anybody else? Yes, ma'am. Sammy O'Berry. Any others? Pray the rain washes the pollen away. Amen. Amen. Peanut? What? Oh, you puppy. Awesome. What's his name? It's a she? It's a Sheba. Oh, you still got Ruger. How many dogs you got? Somebody over here? Brother Leon? Yes, sir. Yeah. Amen. First Brother Leon's granddaughter. Any others? Say it again. The kid's coming back today. Amen. I thought it was quiet on your row. The RA boys are coming back today. Pray for them in the rain. Yes, sir? Pray for our country. Amen. Amen. Any others? Any unspoken this morning? Amen. Let's open up in a word of prayer, and we'll come in and have church. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for this time together, for the folks that's come out to your house. God, we're so thankful that we have a place that we can come to. Lord, you've sheltered us out of the rain. Lord, so many years ago, folks decided to put a church on the corner of this piece of property here on Central and Slaughterville. Lord, I just thank you for the forward-thinking people in this community. God, for the souls that have been saved over the years, Lord, help us to enter into their work and their ministry. Lord, you've always been at work in this area, so God, help us to enter into that work. God, thank you for the people that raised hands, that had people that needed prayer. Lord, I pray you hear them. God, I pray that as people see you work, God, they recognize that you are all-powerful, that you know everything, that you are everywhere, and that, God, they see you at work. We just pray for each prayer request, Lord, that's mentioned, for all the unspoken prayer requests, Lord, there's so many. Just pray, God, you'll be beside each and every one. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. If you'll please stand again and join us if you're able. Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my life, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid rock, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace. When fears are stilled, when striving cease, my comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. Christ alone. By the ones he came to save, till on that cross as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid, here in the death of ground, his body lay, light of the world by darkness slain, then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. Now, if you want to take time to say hey to somebody, I know it's COVID, you might not want to shake your hand, but turn to somebody and wave and say hello, smile at somebody. Cool. if you remain standing. I'm going to ask you to sing one more time. Help me out.
Father, we ask, Lord, that your Holy Spirit would just fall on us in a mighty way this morning. I feel your presence, Lord. I'm thankful for your presence. Thankful, Father, for what you want to do, to revive and restore your church. Father, to awaken this world to the necessity of a Savior. Father, we thank you today, and we ask that you be with us as we give, as you have already given us in so many ways. Bless this time of giving, the tithes and the offerings. Help us, Lord, to be a willing sacrifice to you. Lord, we thank you and praise you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Shall live as one.
who's learned compassion. I've been so I know how fear builds walls instead of bridges. I'll dare to see another's point of view.
Amen. Take your Bibles with me, if you would. Turn to Romans chapter 1. Romans chapter 1, verse 18. A little guy going out last told me the other day he was a daddy's boy. That's good. I think his daddy's right. There he is. Yeah, yeah. He said, I'm a daddy's boy. I said, good for you. Amen. Amen. But take your Bibles, Romans chapter 1, verse 18. Stand with me for the reading of God's perfect word. Romans chapter 1, verse 18 says this. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness. Because that which may be known of God is manifest in them, for God hath showed it unto them. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world, listen, are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that we are without cause, so that we are without excuse. Amen. Let's pray. God, thank you for your word. Thank you, God, that you have, Lord, sat down in this place with us already, Lord. We thank you, God, that you're here. We thank you for our visitors who are with us today, Lord. And we just pray for the people who are having to watch at home today, Lord, for whatever reason. We just pray, God, that today be a life-changing day for somebody. In Jesus' name, amen. If you would be seated. If I titled this, I would title it, When God Shouts His Name. When God Shouts His Name. Now, we all understand and live by the fact that we know about God, that we know some things about God, and sometimes we get things crossed over and we say, well, I know about God because I'm saved, or I know about God because I read the Bible, or I know about God because I was told about Jesus when I was little, and we sang, Jesus loves me. You know, you sang the songs, Lord, or I'm in the Lord's army. You ever sing that song? Remember that? So listen, so we say, well, I know about God because I sang those songs when I was little. Well, let's talk about a few things this morning. I want to tell you why God has revealed himself to mankind. Why God has revealed himself to mankind. First of all, God has a strong desire to reveal himself. God wants, listen, for the Christian in this room, God wants to reveal himself specifically in specific areas for specific reasons just for you. God wants to talk to you. Listen, God's got direction for your life. And listen, God don't always just tell me what's for your life. Very seldom do I find that to be true at all. Listen, God has got direction just for you. You have to listen. You have to put yourself in a spot, in a prayerful mindset, to be able to hear from God. First of all, you got to be saved. Listen. Second of all, you got to pray and get all the junk out. You all right? God ain't going to bless the mess you started. So go ahead and pray and ask God to cleanse you. Lord, cleanse me so that I can enter into your presence. Lord, cleanse me, Lord, so that my prayers are reached the throne. Lord, cleanse me. So we got to get things cleaned up. And thirdly, listen, we just got to listen. And how about this? Cooperate. God wants to do some things in your life. God wants to do some things that will change, not just as a Christian. You say, Brother Ray, I'm saved already. Listen, there's so much more to it. Because I want God, Brother Hal, I want God to open his word up to me so I can know more about him. He's given me every way to know him through his book. This is what we call, the book is what we call specific revelation, brought down by men who God inspired to pen this word so that we'd know what God's intent was for us as people. It'd be bad if we had to go through the word that's passed down all the way back from Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, from Moses' day, to have it passed down. Listen, God wrote it down for us. Yeah, if people always, when they call me, they'll say, Brother Ray, when they call me about an air conditioning problem, they'll say, Brother Ray, I got a problem with my air conditioner. I said, okay. And really, we don't need to talk more than that. Just let's set up a time, I'll be over. No. People say, well, here's what's doing. Over the phone. You know, so they'll begin to talk about it, and they'll say, well, it's making this funny noise, and they'll make the noise. And then they'll say, the other day it was cold outside and smoke was coming out of it. I don't know, it's working now, but you need to look at it. You know, listen, people's got a story to tell. People want to talk. They want to try to identify in your mind so you can try to listen. I got to get there and put my hands on it. I can try to tell you what's good in your life. I can try to tell you what God would have to say in your life, but I can only do it through this revealed word. I can only do it through this manual. And it's like I tell people about their air conditioner. Listen, the only way I can do anything about it is if I go over and see it and turn the power, put my gauges on it, check the electricity, let it run, hear it, and smell it. They have things burn up. People that know are going, you ever touch one that shock you? That's bad. That's bad. Ever drunk from a water fountain that shock you? That's bad. But see, those things right there will give you an idea that something's wrong. In your life today, if the devil has headway in your life, if he's able to lead in some directions in your life, there's a problem. There's a problem. Listen, if he has a beachhead, if you give him some space in your life, and there's some things that's starting to grow that doesn't look like God, there's a problem. Listen, and you need to address it, because we want to hear what God has to say to us and for us. Now, God manifests himself to man in millions of ways every day. So we have two different ways. We have the general a revelation where God, we have this revelation from God to all mankind. God has made himself available, and people are aware that there's a God. Like, you know, I see the flowers, I see the trees. It's broad in scope, if you will. We can, even a lost person can stand back and see that there's some things that we just can't quite explain. I wrote a few of them down. Turn a page here so I can get these things to you. First of all, how about this? Think about the seed that becomes a mighty tree. God had to do some planting in nature to allow things to grow like that. I mean, if it was the Big Bang theory, if it's the Big Bang what that happened, wouldn't it be just, it started and that's it? It just grew. I don't understand how people can have that kind of faith that those kind of things lined up because of an explosion. Everything I've seen explode don't pan out real good. Everybody else all right? I mean, I blew up some stuff in my lifetime. My daddy had the big idea of what's that stuff they shoot? The Tannerite? Yeah. That's the craziest thing in my life, says a 76-year-old man. Enjoy wasting his money on Tannerite. He loves it. People in the neighborhood, well, Larry's shooting Tannerite again. But listen, he'll put it in stuff, blow it, the kingdom come. And you know, I can go out there, and if he puts that in a washing machine and blows that thing sky high, it will never land back in order. It never does. Listen, if you put a book out there and it blows up a million pieces, it never lands back in order. That's the craziest thing. Somebody could believe that we could explode, a big bang, and then we somehow grow out of something. Listen, God made us in the likeness of him, in his own image. Yes, and I tell you, it's hard to believe something. How about this? Think of the birds that are able to navigate by the stars. Even when they are raised in a windowless room and are shown artificial sky, they're able to turn themselves in the right direction. I've often wondered about that. I mean, what about the birds that, I'm going to Hawaii. I'm not going to South America this year. That's it for me. I'm staying in Canada. I'm just going to South Carolina. You know they got a Myrtle Beach? I mean, wouldn't it be something if they decided to do their own thing? No. They all follow a course. Isn't that something? There's certain times of year. I was out in the swamp yesterday, and I was looking at the flowers, and not one flower. There's bonnets that come out, and poof, they had the prettiest flower coming out of them. Gazillions of them are about to burst forth. I can't hardly wait to go out and see them maybe next week. I'm afraid I'm going to miss them, you know. But all of them are up, the stalk is up, and they're white in the base, and they're ready to go. And there's not just one, and there's another that's already made, and there's one over here, there's one over there, dead from, it's already, no, they're all about to do it at the same time. Yeah, okay, every single one of them is going to come forth probably the same morning. It's almost like God says, now. Almost like God said, now. I look forward to that. How about this? Think about the giant telescopes that can view objects that are over 4 billion light years away. That's a distance of 20 million septillion miles. I don't know why that's important. Think that most scientists now believe that this massive universe came into existence at a specific instance in time. Listen, the news aren't telling you that, but scientists believe that we all came into existence at a specific time. Do you know that among major scientists, evolution is very much out of vogue? Many now suspect that a higher intelligence had everything to do with it. Think that at any given instant, there are over 1,800 storms in operation on this earth at any given time. The energy needed to create those storms and sustain those storms amounts to the incredible figure of 1,300,000,000 horsepower. You think about the storms. How does a storm just sweep across the earth in the direction that it wants to go? Think that there are over 10 million species of insects, 10 million different type bugs on this earth. How'd they all make it? A creator. That's how. You know, we look at different things and we see how things are. Think that the head of a comet can be 10,000 to a million miles long and travels at a speed of 350 miles a second. realize that light from the sun travels at 186,000 miles per second. At that rate, it would take 125,000 years just to travel across our galaxy, and the Milky Way is just one galaxy among billions. I think about all the things that I see. How about this? Anybody like going to the mountains? You know, and it seems like all the leaves kind of change together. You say, oh, that's because the temperature changes. You know, that temperature don't change in July. It always changes about October, November. You know, God has a specific plan. We see God. That's general revelation. That's God's gift to all mankind. But it's not redemptive. There's no way that a person can be saved by seeing beautiful trees. There's no way somebody can come to the knowledge that they need a Savior by the grass. I love rocks, and I like old rusty stuff, and I like to think about what pioneers might have done in that area long before we were there. How they might have worshipped, and how they might have sang, and some of the issues they might have had. And I like to think about the history in a place. But I love walking through the woods when it's really quiet. I was in the swamp yesterday, like I said, and as I rode through there, I saw all the bonnets about to burst forth, and I looked out, and there was one single tree way out there, and I got to looking, and the tree took up about 10 feet. I'm telling how many years it took that tree to get to 10 feet high. It was scraggly and gnarly and knotty. You wouldn't get it to plant in your yard. That tree was rough. Listen, that tree had to put up with a lot of stuff. There's no telling how long it floated till it finally got a little purchase in dry weather to drop its root far enough down to stay in that one spot so that it could actually start growing above the ground. Listen, in that tree was a bird nest. And I got thinking, Lord, you allowed a tree to land on a piece of mud that's floating around in the swamp. How many years did it take? All the things that you saw, and yet none of it took you by surprise. You allowed a small tree to get just big, just high enough so that the alligators couldn't jump there and grab the little birds. It's just high enough where you stay just out of reach, and you knew there's birds. I couldn't see them or hear them, but it's like it'd been used over and over. There's different colored feathers, and different colored birds was using it over the years. One little spot. I got thinking, you know, and on a song, you know me, the song came up, what a mighty God we serve, what a mighty God we serve. And I got thinking about, as I rode through there, and I was looking around, that, God, how in the world can a group of people stand back and say, there is no God? How can they do that? They just need, listen, they need a trip through South Georgia. That's all they need, amen? So we have general revelation. First of all, notice where God reveals himself. Notice where God reveals himself. Paul says that God is revealed in them. God's revealed. Look at this in verse 19. Because that which may be known of God is manifest where? In them. You know, we know the Bible to be true. So God, you have revealed yourself in them. You have shown that you are God, that on this earth there's a creator, there's somebody in charge, that you are above all things, that there is a God. It says here that you have, that because that which may be known of God is manifest in them, for God hath showed it unto them. Them who? All mankind. All mankind can see that there's a God. You know, think about going up to Alaska or down through Canada, never been. One day I'm going to do that. I look forward, I hope maybe this football season, I'm going to USC, get to speak to their football team this year. Well, I'm looking forward to that. I've never been over there. Never been in that part of the country. I can't hardly wait to go and see something different. Where it's at, it's Los Angeles, so probably ain't much of God in there. Amen. I hope there's some good things there. I'm not planning on it. I had to go to the ocean to see it. But listen, when I see God moving things and God in things, the spirit that lives in me, it speaks volumes. It connects. It reminds me that the Creator looked my way and allowed me to see beautiful things. Do you realize God's trying to show you some things? What about this? Now, whenever we hear this, it gives me the idea that even people that has never read the Bible doesn't have an excuse to be saved. Still okay? That God has revealed himself to man, and people make choices, good or bad. Let me read you something that I wrote down from Mr. Wilkerson from Liberty University from like in the 70s. Here's what he wrote. In Revelations 5:9 indicates that people from every tribe and language and people and nation will be saved. This does not mean that every single individual person, whoever lives, will have heard, will have had the opportunity to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. What it does mean is that the gospel of Jesus Christ will be taken to every tribe, language, people, and nation before the end comes, and that some people from every one of these tribes, languages, people groups, and nations will be saved. This is affirmed in Matthew 24:14, which states that this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in the whole world as a testimony to all nations, and then the end will come. But there is a revelation of God that is universal, a revelation that every human being is confronted with every day of their lives, and that challenges everyone to believe in God and leaves everyone without any excuse for unbelief. God's self-revelation in creation. Listen, God has showed us who He is in creation. Give us the idea that there's somebody in charge of it all. We are made to worship. There's something about us that wants to worship. Folks that are atheists will worship basketball. Folks that are atheists will worship the mountains. They'll worship the snow. They'll worship skiing. Listen, we worship all kind of stuff. You say, well, that doesn't mean I believe there's a God. Listen, we are made to worship. People would find the tribes in the far reaches that when they started reaching these places in the early 1900s, they'd say there were some tribes that were just as easygoing. They'd help out. There was something about their moral character. Where'd that come from? Their recognition that somebody's in charge. They'd have different names for God and different things, but they'd all serve and they'd worship and they'd praise and they'd sing songs. And then you'd have those groups that were thrown out. That had whole groups of men, outlaws and folks that would go and try to steal and destroy other groups of people in these people groups. And none of them liked them because why? They'd made a choice to be bad, good and bad. Listen, everything around us lets us know that there's good and bad. I can walk through the woods or I can see, and then I see the trash in the ditches and I realize that man had a part to play in that. You know, they put an ice machine down from where we live at Traders Hill. Now I got trash bags. I got ice bags. I got ice bags on my road as I go by there. They get just enough speed by my house for the bags to fly to the back of the truck. They're right there at the house. So I go pick up trash bags or ice bags. See, before I'd look over at the woods and see how beautiful they were and on the man's property, and every now and then I'd see a squirrel come down. You know what I look over now? See? Ice bags. And I think, Lord, we are messing up what you made. Lord, we're messing up what you made. And we got to understand that God is trying to speak to us in so many different ways. Ephesians 2:1 tells us, Romans 2:1 tells us, therefore thou art inexcusable, O man. Thou art inexcusable. Listen, we don't have an excuse. When people say, well, you know, I just never been in church. Some people say, well, you know, Brother Ray, I just didn't grow up in church, so I got a different outlook on things. That doesn't matter. That don't matter. See, will you worship God or not? You know, where is your creator lie? What are you leaning on for salvation? The only thing about general revelation that we see is it doesn't have the idea of a redemptive plan. That's why Jesus came. See, we have specific revelation as well. And that specific revelation is completely different. It gives us the idea of something, you know, you may have a dream, or people in the Bible had dreams and they was able to pin scripture down. Or the pastor may become with a word that God gave him that week. That specific revelation, when God sent Jesus to the earth to pay our sin debt, that was a specific revelation. God sent down and he had a specific job, specific things, just for that. God has something specific just for you. Listen, you're in here today and there's something going on in your life right now. God's trying to show you something, but for whatever reason, he can't. Could it be that we have things in our life that keep us from being able to hear God's words? The Bible tells us very clearly in the book of John that, listen, if we're loaded down with sin, you better get it all out before you come to pray. That, listen, that's why I pray before I begin to pray. I always say, God, and I just pray you forgive us. Lord, wash away our sins. Lord, let our prayers enter into the throne room. Folks, you got to get your hearts right. Listen, you want to hear specific revelations, you got to be ready. You got to align your life so that God can speak directly to you. Oftentimes we don't. Now, why, Brother Ray, why in the world does God give us specific revelations? Why does God allow us to see all the beauty? I mean, what's he trying to do? He's trying to bring you to a decision. Well, that's what it amounts to. God has allowed you to recognize that he's in nature so you can realize there's a God. And then you can ask yourself another question. Do I want to be where he is? Do I want to be in a place where he's at today? Listen, we have the word now. So when I read the word, it draws me closer to my Savior. It makes me long to be on the other side. When somebody dies and we go through grief on this side, listen to me, it hurts. And we lose people, and it hurts us. And I believe that's even part of the way that God has a specific revelation to us to make us want to be and look forward to being on the other side where there's no more death. See, I look forward to being in glory one day so we don't have any more cancer patients. I'm looking forward to not having to worry about when your children get out on the road and they start driving. I'm already worried. I've seen Emma drive. I ride with her. I'm over here scared to death. I'm mashing brakes with her and steering with her, and I'm doing all kinds of things. We think about all those things together, but God wants to show us who he is so we can make a decision. God desires that every person bow before him in his humble presence. Listen, when did you hear the word? Anybody remember when you got saved? Everybody remember when you got saved? You remember the time that either your granny or your uncle, somebody's prayed for you, was at church, vacation Bible school, you somewhere, and you heard the gospel. You heard the gospel. Listen, it probably wasn't the first time, because you'd been hearing about your whole life, most likely people around here. You've been hearing about it for a long time. But all of a sudden that day, though, it was different. What was different about it? Say it again. Holy Spirit. Hey, God's special revelation to us was the Spirit. It was his Spirit that he put down here for us to lead us and to draw us. Listen, there is nothing like, in Acts chapter 1 says you're going to leave the Spirit to guide us and show us and give us direction. And folks, I got news for you. The Holy Spirit living inside you is that single thing, that single person that draws you to God. God wanted to show you all this earth. Show you how beautiful things are here. I believe so that we can recognize that even as beautiful as things are here, the Bible teaches us that our minds can't even wrap around how great God has it for us when we get to glory. You know, listen, I love to look at beautiful things. Every now and then on my computer, the screen will change, and I like to look at places in Scotland with the grass fields and the rocks and the hills and the little brick buildings where people stay in, little hovels, you know. I always want me one of those. Probably $1 gazillion to own one. I don't know. But when I look and I think about those things and how beautiful they are, I can almost picture myself sitting in them and looking around and wondering what they're about and maybe getting to know the people. Do you ever stop and do that with heaven? Do you ever stop long enough to think about that God has created a place? That's what it says here in the Bible in John 14. He said, don't let your hearts be troubled. Don't worry about things here on this side. He said, I'm going to prepare a place for you. He said, and where I go, I'm going to bring you with me. He said, I'm going to come back and get you. Let me break it down. Don't let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. If you believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, what did he say? I would have told you. He said, I'd have seen some revelation to tell you it wasn't true. But no. He let us believe the best. He let us believe that at some point in the future, Christ is coming. Woo-hoo. Well, where'd we get that from? The book. Jesus said, I'm the door. No man comes unto the Father but by me. So we know that he's coming back. And we know there's only one way to get in. Isn't that good? Isn't that good? There's not a big manual where it's like 15 ways. You go, oh, I can't get in that way. Oh, what if I can get in this way? What if I can get in that way? Nope. Just Jesus. That's what the book says. Hey, just Jesus. So when God sent through his specific revelation, Jesus Christ, he came to this earth for a reason. It was to have a plan for all mankind to be able to go to heaven. God has brought you to a place of decision. That's what it's all about. That's why God's revealed himself. You know, I titled this earlier and I said, when God shouts his name, he didn't have to. He didn't have to. He didn't have to give us this book. But John 3:16 is true, isn't it? For God so loved this world that he gave. Listen, he gave and gave and gave. You sitting here in this room right now, everybody, all of you may not be saved. And there may be somebody in here that say, Brother Ray, you know, I've never accepted Christ. I know there's a God. That's how I was. Real white, that's how I was. I knew there was a God. And I just kind of assumed that somewhere down the road it would kind of work itself out. August 29th, 1992, God sent specific revelation to me. I recognized that night that if I didn't get my heart right, that if I didn't ask Jesus to come into my heart, I was going to die and go to a devil's hell. That was specific revelation to a lost person. God showed me direction. What did I do? I got saved. I thought that that was my last night. In my mind, Bravon, that was it. That was the last time, because God had come by before. And I kept saying, no. But that night, for whatever, that was as hard as conviction, and as, listen, I was as broken down with conviction as I've ever been in my life. Anybody else ever been there? I recognized that was it for me. I went down to the altar. I accepted Jesus as my Savior. But it's never been the same now. When I opened this book, it means something different now. See, before when I read the book, Brother Ronnie, the Holy Spirit wasn't living in me. I could read the book. It was just a book. I can quote Psalms 23 to you. I could quote it lost because I remembered it for a play one time, but it didn't mean anything. But boy, when I got saved, Brother Hal, the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. You know, I get thinking about the scriptures now, and the Holy Spirit bears witness with this revealed word that God gave us. And it gives me direction. It gives me direction for you guys. It gives me something to preach when I come up here, and hopefully we all get on the same page. But just for me personally, it makes me long for something that I hadn't seen yet. I can't wait to hear the singing over there. But I know that was awesome today. But you know, I'm looking forward to a day. I wonder what that new song is going to be like, brother. I've often wondered, is it going to be like a big stadium where these different rows of the angels or the saints that have gone on before around us, but the redeemed come in, you know? And we begin to sing that new song at the top of our voices, realizing that all our faith has bore seed. All our faith, all the times that we got on our knees and all the times that we gave when we didn't really have it to give, all the times, we're here. We're here. I'm looking forward. God's revealed it to me. Listen, God has revealed not the word and how to be saved. That's what God's revealed to me. My own imagination, man, I like to think about the greatest. He said my mind literally can't wrap around it. So I try hard. I try hard to vision what God has. I try to think about what it's going to be like after we're there, like for a million years. I hope you can't gain weight. Yeah. That'd be great. I hope I'm skinny, you know. And then I hope there's other fat people where I can say, you need to lose a little weight there, buddy. See, I'm looking forward to that. I was somewhere yesterday. No. I was at a ball game. I was chaplain for the baseball team. I was talking to some fellas, and an old timer came up to me, and Mr. Joe Lester Chester, he patted me on the belly and said, your wife's feeding you good. I said, don't nothing get past you, does it, Mr. Joe Lester? Amen. Well, I hope there's fat people in heaven. I can go by and say, yeah, you need to cut back, buddy. You know, you say, Brother Ray, that's cheese. That's all silly. I don't dwell on hell. Hell don't enter my... I don't sit in my bed at night wondering, I wonder what it's going to be like. The only time I do is when I'm getting ready to preach for it, trying to, but I have a hard time in my mind trying to focus on what it's going to be, because it's not part of my future. It's not part of my reality. Hey, at some point in the future, Christ come to get me, I'm going to glory. Amen. Listen, the thing that God is wanting us to know more than anything else is that He loved you enough to give His only Son, just one Son, to die on a cross, to pay your sin debt, so that you'd have an opportunity to be where He is when you die. He revealed that to us through Jesus. Listen, this morning as you come, I just wonder, is everybody here saved? What if today was today? And I'm going to tell you something. Some people get embarrassed at a time like this because they think, well, I've been in church my whole life, and people will think that, I mean, if I come up, they'll think, man, I thought he was saved. He's been doing stuff. He wasn't saved. Listen, they will rejoice with you. I can remember the first revival I ever preached was at a little church called Browntown out in Popleville out that way. And a lady, I preached, I didn't hardly know anything. I'll be honest with you. I was just excited, you know. I was more excitement than anything. I was all fire, no smoke. But I preached that week. And I just tried to show them my heart. One night I just gave them a testimony. I cried through it and prayed through it and preached through it. And there was a lady, she in the back every night came, every night, just regular church person. And there's probably 30, 40 people there. The last night she got up and came forward. And in my mind, when people come up, I'm thinking, okay, do I need to just let them pray by themselves, or do they need me to pray with them, or what? Well, she walked right to me, didn't give me the opportunity. So when she locked eyes with me, Brother Leon, I said, well, I wonder what she needs. Bless her heart, probably want to pray for a child. Probably there's a son that's living out in the world, and she wants us to get together and stop and pray for him. When she got to me, she said, I'm lost. She said, I've been a member of this church a long time. I've been in a church my whole life. She said, but I'm not saved. And the preacher heard her. He's an old timer. This was 25 years ago. He come up there beside her. He said, sister, did I hear right that you need to be saved? And she said, yes, pastor, I've never been saved. That whole church rejoiced. Listen, she was one of the leaders. She taught, done all the stuff. When somebody comes to know Christ, it should be a time of celebration. There should be something in us that recognizes it, and it reveals itself. And as we see another that gets what we have, should change us. Hey, listen, for me now as a Christian, the greatest single rush, if you want to call it that, that I have is being beside somebody else that comes to know Christ. Listen, you can't fake it forever. And you've heard me say it before, you can't stay here. Jesus is coming. He's revealed. Listen, you don't have no excuse. You're not going to be able to get there and say, well, Lord, I just didn't know. No, you've seen the Satilla River when the mist is just over the tops of the water and it's slick as glass. You've seen it. Listen, you've got up in late in the evenings and went outside and heard the whippoorwills. You've heard it. You've seen the beautiful things that God has. You know there's a God. Listen, and now you've heard what Jesus has to say, that he's prepared a place for you. He said, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. That's you. That's your opportunity. That whosoever is you. That's you. That's your name. What will you do? What if Christ comes back today? I won't be here to preach for you Wednesday. I won't be here next Sunday. Probably won't have a song leader. What will you do? What will you do if Christ comes back and you're left here? What will you do? Choose today. That's why God revealed himself. So we choose. Don't be foolish and wait. Don't wait another day. Don't kind of hope it works out. Know it. Know it. Know what Christ did and know that you're secure. That you're secure. Today's the day. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for today, for salvation, what it means. Lord, for Jesus coming to this earth and dying on the cross, Lord, and paying our debt so that we don't have to pay it ourselves in hell. God, thank you that you've shown us through Jesus what it takes. Help us, God, today. Lord, as the Christians that are here that are struggling, Lord, I pray they get all the stuff out. They know what you expect, Lord. There's no excuse. Lord, there's no excuse not to serve. There's no excuse not to live for you. When we think about heaven and all that you've planned, Lord, when we think about how you have so persevered in our lives and shown us and give us direction and helped us so much, Lord, we should serve you. God, for the lost people that are here this morning, God, I pray that they have the strength to step out of their pew and come down here and say, Brother Ray, I'm lost. I've never been saved. God, I pray for that person today. I pray, God, you give them strength even now. I pray, Lord, through the power of the Holy Spirit of God in Jesus' name, that you bind Satan from this place. Lord, give us this time so people can decide what you've shown them. It's in Jesus' name. Amen. If you would, please stand. You have time. The King's coming. The King's coming. You say, Brother Ray, I know I'm saved. Do you know anybody that's not? Can you imagine that person dying and spending the rest of eternity in a literal burning hell? Listen. Not only has God revealed his word to us, but he's shown us that we need to do our best to try to win those so they don't go there. Are you praying for people? Is God going to look your way one day in glory and say, you should have prayed for people? I don't want to be found not praying for somebody. If you don't know Christ today, it's your day. You know it. God's calling you. What will you do? You don't have tomorrow. You don't have Tuesday or Wednesday. What if Christ was coming back today? What would you do? What would you do? Somebody you need to lift up to the cross, is it real to you? Listen, is what God's shown you real to you? I bet it is. I bet it is. As we see the beauty that God has in this world, and we see all the things that God's shown us, He's proved to us that He is who He says He is. So if He is, this book's true. And if this book is true, time's wasting. I wonder if this time will ring through somebody's ears in glory. Down through eternity, they'll be able to look back and say, you know, I missed that time, and I missed that time, and I missed that time. Here's your chance. Brother Bickner will come up and say, he just wanted to pray for somebody. These folks that you know, they're lost. What do they mean to you? What do they mean to you? What does lost people mean to you? They meant enough to God that He allowed His only Son to die on a cross, the most painful way they could allow somebody to die in those days, through crucifixion. He allowed His Son to die on that cross. What's the lost mean to you? Brother A, I'm fine. I'm good. Man, my heart breaks. My heart breaks for people as I drive to church on Sunday morning. I look over towards the houses, and I don't know, because they're out there cutting grass on Sunday mornings. They're out there doing things that they never think about God's house. And I wonder, Brother Mac, do they know Jesus? Are they just unrepentant? Do they know Jesus? Are they going to get to go to heaven? That's why this church was put here. That's why this church was put here. It was to be a lighthouse for this little area. This church wasn't called to win Waycross. It wasn't even called to win Nahunna. It's called to win this little area called Slaughterville. It's called to win this little area. And we're all part. Listen, we're just privates in a great army. This little area right here. That's why we're here. That's why God sent us to this place. You still have time. You still have time if there's a burden on your heart. I was talking to a baseball player Friday afternoon. And I got there too late. I didn't know the ball game started at 4. I thought it started at 5, and they had a doubleheader. I didn't know it started, so I didn't get to preach. I usually go and speak to the boys, and the time, I was an hour late. And I could see the coach, and if anybody knows Marchman, Coach Marchman, he's a little on the edge. So I didn't bring it up. I just come in, and all the boys, they come in, they want to hug your neck and get you dirty. You know, they're dirty. Get my shirt dirty. They all want to hug on you. And one little boy, as he hugged my neck, he said, pray for me. Just pray for me. He didn't say why. I have no idea. I'm praying for him. I have no idea what's going on. What I can tell you, he's in a broken home where the parent isn't hardly ever home. They're supposed to be watching him. That all the other kids come up there with the nice stuff. His is all school issue. Whatever they have left in the dugout that other kids didn't want, that's what he's got. But he loves Jesus. He's one of them we baptized during football season in the locker room. We baptized 4. Hug neck, he said, pray for me. Listen, spoke. spoke volumes. Why? My heart and his heart. God spoke to my heart and his heart. Remember, people, God needs you to pray for people. God wants you to go to them and let them know that you care. That might be the single thing that brings them out of what they're in. Is folks just, listen, knowing somebody cares. When I had COVID, mine wasn't near like anybody. Brother Tom, bless his heart. Mine wasn't nothing like that. Let me tell you something. The days that I was laying in that bed, worried, when folks would call me or send me a text, listen, I couldn't get enough of them. Because I didn't want to call you and bother you. No, this is awesome. Sometimes I didn't pick up. I just didn't feel good. I couldn't pick up. You leave a message. You leave something. You can't leave a message. I don't have a plan, but you send me a text. And I could remember, and I was thinking about all the people that was praying for me, all the people that loved me, all the people that was praying. There's something about prayer. Something about prayer. Amen. Anybody have anything to say before we dismiss? Amen. Don't forget, tonight's church will be down at the Slaughterville Rec area at 7 o'clock. You can come early. I think that some of the kids down there has a little concession stand with some drinks and stuff so they can make them some extra money. It's the missionaries' kids. So buy a Coke or a drink. If they're $9 each, just pray for them, okay? But I don't know what they are, but they're going to have some little drinks. It's the kids, they're out in ministry too, amen? So if you can't help them out, but let's all meet down there a little early and maybe pray and get ready and get ready to sing. Maybe the rain's gone. Anybody before we go? If not, Brother White, would you dismiss us?